We just want to party. All right. Welcome back to another episode of the Orlando Soccer Show as we get brought into this episode by the Grammy award-winning song by Childish Gambino, This Is America. We got a lot to talk about this week, so as the bass gets in and the song starts, let's welcome in Gavin Ewbank and Mike Gramajo. Guys, how you doing?
Doing pretty well, you know, a day removed from a 7-hour car drive back from Northwest to North Carolina, and very done with driving in general now, so excited to be sitting down.
I can imagine that. More than 2 hours is rough. Seven hours, just no.
Yeah, once you get like into that third, fourth hour, it just really starts to wear down on you. Especially like on the way home when you're getting out of the Carolina mountains and then you're just in Georgia and it's just all flat pavement.
Yeah, I could definitely see that. Anyway, yeah. Mike, are you there?
Yeah, no. I had a 10-hour day at UCF today. So
rough.
It's somewhat. I had a tennis class this morning. It's an elective I have to take. So that's why I can't make it training on Monday mornings, but I'm getting a little fit with the tennis class on Monday mornings, and then I'm usually just in the library. For some reason, every Monday, I always pass by Kevin Mercer, and we just fist bump because he's on his way to class to teach, and I'm on my way to the library. And we have a little small chat sometimes, Orlando City related, Orlando Pride. But, yeah, it's my Mondays. And it's obviously we're getting a lot closer to the start of the season. We have some preseason games to get out of the way, but obviously the start of the season will be here. Next thing you know it.
Yeah.
I haven't seen Kevin in like a minute. How's he doing?
He's doing good. He's teaching at UCF some history classes. I'm pretty sure he's listening. So
yeah. For those who don't know who we're talking about, Kevin Mercer used to be a beat writer for Orlando City, for the mainland for a number of times. He kind of quit and came back, but he's got a very unique writing style and a very good voice.
He has a very historian approach to soccer. Obviously he had the Our City column at the mainland, which I enjoy reading. But then obviously he has the Soccer Scholar, where he kind of takes a little dive into with a historian angle approach about talking about soccer. So yeah, that's my boy. I always see him Mondays and Wednesdays sometimes when I'm walking to class or going to the library. Yeah. So,
you know, fun story. He was actually going to be the MLS beat writer for MLSsoccer.com at one point. But then he wasn't able to do it because he was too busy. And, well, now you're the one.
I'm the one, I guess. But it's, you know, we've been covering this game now for a while now, so
yeah.
I was actually almost the original Orlando City beat writer, but I was in high school at the time, so I could not do it.
That's when you were running O-Town's 11, right?
Simon Borg got in contact with me and I just didn't have the time to do it.
Yeah, I don't know how I've been able to find time. That's actually a good question. That's the question of the year. How have I been able to find time to cover this team for almost 8 seasons?
If you love something enough, you'll find the time for it.
That's very true. So
hard to love this team though.
Either that, or you just wing it, because I've been winging these last 8 seasons, and it's paid off in the long run.
Yeah, fair enough. All right, let's jump into it. We've spent 4 minutes of inside baseball. It's time to get inside soccer. Let's talk Orlando City. We'll start with the Louisville scrimmage that Mike and I were both present at for 20 minutes instead of the usual 15. We got an extra 5. Shout out to Matt Bodiford for being nice to us. But only 20 minutes of the first half of the action between Orlando and Louisville. It was a very interesting game because, well, Louisville is coming off a USL championship. And Orlando is coming off a season where they were second to last in MLS. Some would say it's a fairly even game, even if it is in preseason with just about everybody from Louisville returning and a lot of new faces for Orlando City. But Orlando came out with a 1-0 victory, a goal from Jean Moutinho off a rebound from a shot from Tesho Akindele, and that was about 10 minutes after we had left, so probably 35th minute or so. And that was the only scoring that Orlando or Louisville had. It finished 1-0. Orlando ran out a 3-5-2 or a 5-4-1. That's basically the formation. So 3-5-2 in attack, and then a 5-4-1 in defense. So Akindele was the lone striker in defense, and then Chris Mueller joined him in attack. That's basically, for all you formation critics or whatever, that's how they rolled out.
Enthusiasts.
Yeah, that's the one. Formation enthusiasts, not critics. Either way, it was interesting to see them out there playing. Greg Ranjitzing was in goal. Kyle Smith, the wingback, was wearing the captain's armband. That got a lot of people talking because, well, they're curious if Kyle Smith is going to be the captain for Orlando City this year. I hesitate to say yes or no simply because it's very possible that he could be named the captain for the team, but it's also very possible it was just for this game because it's Louisville. Yeah. It's his old team.
I doubt Kyle Smith will get the – I mean, obviously we haven't been able to get that much access when it comes to these preseason. Obviously we'll see more with the Orlando City Invitational coming this weekend. But, I mean, I would think probably a veteran gets the armband. Will Johnson – Clutch a question.
Will has worn the armband before, and out of all the players that were on the field this past weekend, he would have been the most veteran player.
Well, that has actually. You also imagine Christian Higuita, but obviously last week's comments is not very forthtelling of what's going to happen.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot up in the air. We'll get to Christian in just a second. I just want to finish out the Louisville talk. No, I mean, they look good in possession. They had some good stops on the break. Kyle Smith, the reason I want to harp on him so much is because he actually kind of impressed me. A lot of tracking back. I mean, he's a hustle guy. He's the guy that'll go put 110% effort on, similar to Will Johnson, but younger and more versatile, I guess. I can see a lot of why Kyle Smith is made the jump from USL to MLS. Hopefully he can continue that in the rest of the season. But no, he made some good defensive plays, and just positioning wise, you know, he was very sound when it came to shutting down the counter. Like if one of the center backs from the three in the back stepped out to shut down the wing, he'd be right there in great position to stop out the cross. And did that a few times, actually. There were some good, clean crosses that were away, but Smith was right there to head it away. So he was involved in a lot of defensive plays, and being a wing back, he made his way up into the attack as well. Had a good cross about 12 minutes in that just missed Akindele's foot as he was heading towards goal. It just kind of bounced a little bit away from him, but it was a good opportunity. And again, Smith just kind of all over the place. Another player that kind of... He didn't stand out to me per se, but he definitely left an impression, was Sebastian Mendez, the new midfielder. It almost looked like he wasn't really playing. He wasn't playing a defensive or central midfield role, more, if anything, an attacking midfield role, right? The three in the middle, because if you have the two wing backs, you have three in the midfield. It was more Cam Lindley and Will Johnson as like defensive midfielders, and then Mendez was playing a little bit higher, kind of next to or right behind the strikers. Definitely an interesting look for Orlando City. And Mendez, he's still learning the way James O'Connor wants to play. There were a lot of times where he was kind of putting passive pressure on whoever had the ball, and then James had to yell at him, Seba, pressure, 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 and then he had to run after him. I think that's going to be something of a learning curve for Mendez, is that he just has to get used to pressing high and pressing early and pressing often, because that's how James O'Connor wants his more forward guys to play. So that's something, again, with the preseason that they've had, will help in terms of just stamina and being able to press like that. You'll get a better look of what the team will kind of try in that preseason invitational that they're coming up this weekend. But I've talked for enough. Mike, did you see anything that I didn't mention?
Well, no, I wasn't at the Louisville game.
Were you? You weren't?
I was not. It was an afternoon when I was at UCF. So you probably saw more than me, but I was.
That's right. You weren't. Yeah, that's right.
I was at Ewbank's training, where obviously Sebastian Mendez spoke a little bit about the way he performed. And I was able to obviously write a story later on him for MLSsoccer.com. But I mean, from the reactions I got from, I spoke to mostly the Spanish speaking players the following day. And the reaction I got from most of them from in regards to the Louisville friendly was that it was, I guess, obviously it was somewhat of a learning curve, especially for Sebastian Mendez, because he doesn't really know the language. He's still learning the system. He's still learning somewhat of the club culture that James O'Connor is kind of trying to instill in the team. Obviously, from if they read my story on MLSsoccer.com on Sebastian Mendez, he kind of spoke about how James O'Connor and Luis Muzzi really wanted Mendez at Orlando City. Luis Muzzi went as far as to contacting Mendez. And that kind of showed his, you know, that kind of intrigued Mendez from his end. And he's like, okay, if this club really wants me, then I'm going to go over there. So, and then obviously I spoke with Coleman, another player too, is going to try to have a better year two after a really disappointing year one. He mentioned how horrible year one was because there was a lot of expectations. He felt like he let a lot of people down, including himself. So yeah. And then obviously you spoke with Christian Higuita, which I guess you can kind of leeway to that, when I'm done talking here.
Yeah, well, I mean, you mentioned it, and you wrote the story about it, and you talked to him. So he basically said he wasn't sure if he was going to be with Orlando City this year. Go ahead and elaborate on what he told you.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, the team kind of tried to make sure he didn't talk. Mind you, Christian Higuita was the last person the media was able to talk to. Media, given it's me and Jordan Clover. So he was the last one, and we spoke to Christian Higuita right before he joined the team for training. And obviously, yeah, Christian said some comments that I guess kind of sparked some attention to the Orlando City fan base, where he kind of said that he spoke to James earlier this season, before the season even started, and James told him flat out, he said, I'm being honest, James told me he's not going to count on me. And obviously, yeah, he worked so hard this offseason to be fit. Because obviously, if you remember last year, Higuita came unfit, a little bit overweight, according to Jason Christ. And obviously, Christian Higuita tried to make sure that didn't happen again. He said he trained a lot this offseason to make sure he's fit. But when he found out that he was not going to be really involved in the plans, he felt like, well, if I'm not going to contribute here, I prefer to contribute elsewhere. And obviously he was asked if there were clubs being offered, but he kind of dodged that question, saying that there's nothing happening right now. And then obviously I asked him the last question, whether he sees a future, and obviously kind of expressed a little displeasure in being with the team since the inaugural MLS season, and being wishing that the team would have made the playoffs or have made some type of progress throughout these last four seasons. So obviously, yeah, we don't really. Christian's future is unclear with Orlando City. He's the longest tenured Orlando City MLS player after Earl Edwards was sent to DC United. So it's interesting too, because if you think about it, Christian Higuita has been an anchor at that midfield. Yes, he racks up yellow cards left to right, but he's one of those players that's kind of grown and somewhat become a leader in that midfield. He's been able to establish that partnership with Yuri, with Yoshi, with Carlos Asquez when he came later in the summer. So it's definitely going to be interesting how things unfold with Christian.
So just to clarify the time frame, basically, of Higuita's situation. So was he told that he wasn't going to be a part of the plans and then went to go get fit, or got fit, then was told he wasn't going to be a part of the plans?
According to what he said, it was basically before the start of preseason. So he obviously that discussion with James O'Connor didn't really happen at all during the offseason. He obviously, when the season ended early for Orlando City, all of the players were given offseason regimens they had to abide by. Obviously, Christian was one of those players that was definitely, you can even go through, you know, if you look at his Instagram previous posts, kind of shows how he spent his offseason training, and obviously before the start of preseason camp, or during preseason. So I'm going to correct myself there. There was a discussion. I'm not sure whether it was before preseason or during preseason or at the start of preseason, but there was a discussion that took place between James O'Connor and Christian Higuita. And Christian Higuita said that James told him that he wasn't going to be very involved in this season's plans.
Okay, so this was after he had made all that progress working out. Then he came in and was basically told, like, we don't know what your role is going to be here.
Pretty much. And okay. Then obviously that kind of he expressed a little disappointment in that because he trained so hard this offseason to not come into this preseason camp unfit like he did last year. And then he kind of expressed his displeasure on the team missing the playoffs and obviously working this hard to be here. But if he's not wanted here, then he'd rather play elsewhere.
Right. The way that James O'Connor likes to work things is he wants players to show him that they belong, show him that they deserve to be a part of the team, that they deserve minutes, you know, and that's with any coach really that is good at what they do. They want players to work their hardest to show that they deserve to be there. And I think with James, you know, he sees other guys working hard and, you know, he kind of knows from last season, he has an impression of Higuita. So at this point, I feel like it's up to Christian to be able to work and prove himself to James. But if it's past that point, then yeah, I don't know.
I mean, looking at it from a different perspective, you think about it too. I mean, Christian has been with the club since 2015. How many he's endured? What he's played under three coaches now, one interim if you count Bobby Murphy. Yeah, obviously it's,
he's endured a lot, you know, he's been around. He's the closest that Orlando City has to a 100, games played. You think he's at 94? Yeah, 94. So he has to play six more to get that century mark, which, you know, would be the first in Orlando.
And it would be quite a milestone because, I mean, I don't think it's ever been reached. Therefore, if you combine the USL days.
Oh, no, that the 100%. If you combine USL and MLS, they're guys that have passed over 100.
Okay, so. Yeah.
Like, Bowden, I think, is the, I want to say he's the leader, and then Molino's second, Laren's third. Or, no, Higuita's third now.
Yeah.
But I think if I'm remembering correctly, that's how the hierarchy goes. I can double-check that. But, yeah, so that's the Higuita situation. Going back to Josue Coleman, you talked to him. He had just recently gotten his green card. Now Yuri Rossell apparently has his as well. I mean, that's big for Orlando City now, right?
It opens up an international spot, which is always a plus because you can now kind of – well, you can't have more than 30 players on the roster. But then it's MLS rules always get in the way. But then you can only have a certain amount of international players. But – obviously, with Orlando City letting go, and I'm pretty sure we'll talk about it in just a moment, releasing Tommy Madden, right?
Yeah.
That's Tommy Madden and then Scott DeVos, releasing them. Obviously, that frees up a roster spot and can be an international player if they're going to pursue that. But it's always a plus when you have an international spot freed up.
Yeah. Absolutely. Okay. I've got the spreadsheet in front of me. Let's take a quick look. Luke Bowden, combined with USL and MLS, has 150 appearances for Orlando City. Kevin Molino has 144. Dennis Chin, 103. Now, if you count his league appearances plus his US Open Cup appearances, Christian Higuita has 97.
All time.
Correct. League appearances, 94. So if you count league appearances, it's still Bowden, Molino, and Chin up top. But Chinny has also playoff appearances and U.S. Open Cup games to consider, which is why he's at 103. But league appearances, he's only 84. Bowden with 132 league appearances, Molino with 124. So actually, Higuita leads. He's in third in league, fourth overall. And correct. Then, let's see, the next person would be Joe Bendick.
He's gone.
Yeah, Miguel Gallardo,
not really gone,
Rob,
but
yeah, Rob Valentino, Kyle Larin, Carlos Rivas, Kaká. Kaká finished with 75 leagues, 78 total. Then you had Darwin Serén, which was very interesting. He had 70 total appearances combined with USL and MLS. Then Jamie Watson, Adam Mbengue, Eric Ustruck, he had 61 total appearances. Tommy Redding, he's got 60. Seb Hines, Will Johnson's creeping up there. Dom Dwyer's currently at 56. I could keep going, but you get the idea. Oh, and then James O'Connor, he's currently 23rd. No, 22nd all time in appearances. Fun fact.
Sounds great.
All right, well, that's that. That's a fun fact for you there. So, you talked about Scott DeVos being released, or Tommy Madden being released. Scott DeVos was just released today, being Monday, and then RJ Allen was waived last week. So that's two more spots opened up, potentially. Since DeVos was never signed, it doesn't really count against that. But RJ was waived, so that opens up another roster spot. So they haven't officially signed
Kamal Miller.
Yeah, they haven't signed Kamal Miller, but he's expected to be signed.
Brian Rowe.
Brian Rowe also has not been signed, but he's training with the team. So that's two potential signings.
I mentioned this at when were you at training, Austin, last week?
Whenever James talked, I don't remember.
Wednesday?
Must have been. Or Tuesday. Tuesday.
I mentioned Wednesday, watch Brian Rowe be the Chris Schuler of this year, where he's going to be training with the team all preseason, and then
he'll be the last one signed.
The day before the season starts.
Yeah. Now, that would also, I mean, you got to think there's four goalkeepers competing now for the starting spot. You've got Rowe, who has not been signed, but then you have the three actual rostered goalkeepers in Ranjit Singh, Adam Grinwis, and Mason Stadahar.
But who has the most MLS experience? Brian Rowe.
Right, but he's not signed. Out of the ones that are signed, it's Grinwis with just a handful of games.
Yeah, but it makes you wonder, though, if Rowe does get signed, does that make him the automatic starter?
I wouldn't say so. No, I mean, the way that Tabani Sutu described it in Jordan's article the other day is the competition's completely open, right? It all depends on who proves themselves for the rest of the preseason. They've got three more opportunities. They've got the preseason game, the closed-door scrimmage against the Philadelphia Union, and then you've got the two games against New York City and New England Revolution in the Invitational. So that's three games, and then you've got a friendly against Minnesota. So you've got four games of preseason left to be able to prove themselves.
Still a lot to play for then.
Right. You won't get an idea until basically, you know, a few days before the season starts.
Have they even announced when media day is?
That is a negative.
I mean, a lot of questions that need to be asked, though.
A lot of questions. Here's a question. Will Dom Dwyer be a part of media day?
Yeah.
Doesn't it seem like less, like every year we get less and less like information as preseason goes on?
Yeah. I mean, last year we got almost nothing because of Jason's crazy, like, oh, I don't want my secrets getting out mentality.
Yeah.
This season, I mean, they're hosting their own invitational for preseason, which fans can attend. That hasn't been done since 2015.
Got to market the club somehow.
Yeah.
What, having fans be able to come to games?
Yeah. I mean, you got to start selling that game day experience early.
I had the Bahia one in 2016.
Was that preseason? That's right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Old Seb Hines, four goals. Never forget.
Never forget that night.
Nope. All right. Speaking of Brazilian clubs, though, there has been an actual move between the partnership of Orlando City and Atlético Paranaense, outside of Leo Pereira, who was loaned to OCB and then subsequently loaned up to Orlando City 2 years ago. God, that was 2 years ago now, wasn't it?
I just thought about that right now, too. I was like, ooh. Wow, 2 years ago? All right.
It's amazing to see, because Leo Pereira just won a championship with Paranaense as the starting center back.
I really liked him in that back line 2 years ago, even though it was another disappointing season. But
And Orlando City fans were happy that he was gone. They're like, oh, well, thank God we didn't sign him. And Well, now he's like he was being targeted by like Fluminense and Botafogo as like their starting center back.
It was only a season he was low. He played with Orlando. I mean, imagine if they would have let him kind of grow. I mean,
well, yeah. I mean, the thing is with a successful club like Paranaense, you have that. You can afford that, right? You can afford that time to be able to let a player grow by having him play, you know, sporadically and still be able to win games because you're just that good. Orlando City couldn't afford that opportunity because they weren't good. Anyways, back to Atletico Paranaense. Pierre da Silva, it's not official yet, but he's there. And from this is what I've heard, he has been loaned for the season to Atletico Paranaense from Orlando City with the option to buy.
Interesting. Well, not interesting, but at the same time, makes sense. I mean, you got to play the kid.
This is the what basically what we talked to Luis Muzy a few weeks ago. He said, you know, because I asked him about the partnerships that Orlando City has. I'm like, well, I mean, what are you doing with them? And he's like, well, if we don't utilize them, if we don't share secrets, if we don't share players, it's not really a partnership. It's just a partnership in name. And so you see a little bit of Muzy and the front office actually utilizing those partnerships finally by sending players to Paranaense, and now they're getting three Paranaense players for Orlando City B. So that's actually being utilized. We still haven't seen Stoke City be utilized. We haven't seen Wolfsburg be utilized, but that's still fairly new. And then we haven't seen Benfica utilized since 2015 or 2014 when Rafael Ramos and Estrella came over. So and at least
it won 10-0 this past weekend.
I saw that. But at least you see one club getting a bit of movement, and of course it's the Brazilian club. So good for Pierre. He needs the game time. He's coming off an injury towards the end of the season that sidelined him for a few months. He's still working his way back from that. And, you know, Paranaense, he'll be reunited with his best friend, Leo, and hopefully can make something out of it. But, you know, it's possible we won't see him back in Orlando anytime soon if they decide to buy him. So we'll see.
Right. Very true.
So on to tomorrow, which is today being Tuesday. Orlando's playing the Philadelphia Union at Champions Gate. Media only allowed for 15 minutes, and none of us will be there, so follow Jordan Kohler for updates for the first 15 minutes, and that's it.
I mean, what can we talk about that?
Nothing. Thing? Literally nothing. That's it. It's happening at Champions Gate. From what I understand, Orlando City's media, social media, will provide updates, score updates at the least, and occasional video, along with a recap video. Eventually, you'll be able to see what happened in that game, but That's just about it. Let's talk about rumors, guys. There's rumors involving Orlando City now, of course, because James O'Connor has said he's not done with his team yet. He wants to make some more moves. He wants to bring some more people in. And so let's kind of go chronologically. We'll start with the most recent and then work our way back. So the most recent, which is Monday evening, it has come out that Bruno Godot, who's a Belgian center back, is apparently Orlando City is interested in him. He has played for Anderlecht with former Anderlecht player Sasha Kljestan, and he's a European center back. Orlando seemed to need some more center back depth, so go for him. Why not? He's played in 23 matches in the Pro League this year. He's 26 years old. He's a left-footed defender. He's 6'2". Yeah, 6'2". Had a double check on that. He's been all around Belgium. He's basically played in Belgium his entire career. Started with the youth team in Anderlecht and has made his way kind of around the league. I don't know. Any opinions, guys?
I don't know. I always try to, I mean, if you guys can look at my tweets, I try to not to comment on rumors because, but it's always interesting to see who, when I do see rumors, it's always interesting to see who is being linked with Orlando because I always try to connect it to what position is needed most filled at Orlando City. And yeah, I mean, the team could use another center back. I think the team could use another attacking option. Cause if Dom Dwyer is not fully healthy, or if that Dwyer at some point during the season is not, gets knocked up or,
knocked up,
Knock the phone. I don't want to get him mad.
No, the opposite happened.
Well, yeah, but if obviously if Dom Dwyer succumbs to an injury, and Tasho is not up to par, you really want to start relying on your depth as a forward.
Well, that's why you got Santi and you got Benji.
That's true.
And Chris Mueller now. I mean, he was a forward in college. He was moved out to the wing by Jason Kreis.
You also look at, the left wing. If it's not Coleman playing there, but he really wasn't very dynamic. They were very strong last season.
Well, if they're playing wing backs, you're going to have probably Jean Moutinho playing out there.
It also depends on the formation.
Right, and if they're running that 3-5-2 again, you'll probably just see Kyle Smith and Moutinho. Or maybe, I don't know. I think the right back and left back or wing backs are probably the biggest question for Orlando City at this point. Right, because you have Danilo Acosta as another option at left back with Moutinho, and then you've got Juan with Kyle Smith at wingback for the right. So I think that's probably going to be an interesting battle, mainly because with Juan just getting there, you kind of don't know a lot of what he's going to bring to the table.
I really want to know where that, because it's spelled with an R.
Yeah.
But
where's the accent? Where does it make it Juan?
Juan.
Yeah, I don't know. I literally have no idea.
That is the question of the day.
Yeah. Right. So back to rumors. There was a rumor a few days ago that Orlando City offered 300,000 euros for Venezuelan striker Andres Ponce. It's not happening from what I've been told. Orlando City didn't make the offer. They were just linked to them. And he's not coming to Orlando. So that's that. That could change, obviously, but that's all that I've heard right now. Now, the last rumor that I've kind of left for the biggest discussion, I guess, Nani. Apparently, Sporting CP in Portugal looking to move on from their captain, potentially. But also, Freddy Montero wants to go to Vancouver, and Vancouver is interested in bringing him back, but they're not ready to let both of them go. And so a lot of people think that the Nani thing is a pipe dream, that they're never going to get him, or that he's too old, or that this, that, and the other. But I don't know. I want to get your guys' thoughts on if Nani would actually fit with Orlando City.
I don't know. Well, I mean, the question I have is, they're going to have to pay a transfer fee. Or is it going to be a free transfer? How long is his contract with Sporting?
2020.
So Orlando will have to pay a transfer fee, but I have so many questions. There's so many questions to ask because knowing how MLS, you need to kind of claim a discovery, right? I mean, there's usually
from what I remember, I think that they claimed discovery on him a few years ago.
Orlando.
Yeah, Orlando did.
Well, okay. So let's say Orlando has obviously first dibs on him. Mm-hmm. Will they want to pay those? I mean, I'm curious to know what the transfer fee is being proposed from Sporting. And if they put think about it. This is a team that didn't want to spend, what, almost $10 to $12 million on Chicharito?
They did. They did want to, and they almost did. They had the papers done.
I think, if I can recall, Chicharito's agent wanted a little bit more. It wasn't the agent, but the club, Manchester United, wanted more. Mm-hmm. And that's when Orlando, they didn't really want to cough out money.
Yeah, but I mean, also $12 million is a lot. Just remember that.
Yeah, I mean, it's looking like Transfer Market has his value at about $5 million right now.
Chicharito or Nani?
I'm talking about Nani. Yeah, no, Chicharito's a little...
Chicharito's, his whole thing is done.
His value in coming to MLS is got to be half of what it was four years ago.
Here's the thing. His contract is until 2020, but his contract option is for 1 year. So he has a club. It's a club option. So if they decline the option, then he could just go.
Yeah.
But it's up to the club at that point.
My thing is, I don't think he's too old. He's only 32. I mean, he's primarily what, a winger.
Yeah.
I mean, like, Orlando City could certainly probably use a player of his talents. Well, I don't know where they would plan to fit him into a five.
I would put him as a second striker. I would put him as a second striker.
Yeah, if you're putting him up there next to Dom, I guess. Like, if those two can kind of figure out a way to play off each other.
I would imagine he knows English too, because he played at Man United for a while, and obviously he was teammates with Cristiano Ronaldo. Look, Cristiano Ronaldo speaks pretty good English from his time at Man United. So even if obviously we're talking about Nani, a Portuguese international, I don't think if it were hypothetically to happen, I don't think there will be no language barrier, because obviously Nani would be able to communicate with most of the attackers and Chris Mueller or Don Dwyer.
Mm-hmm.
But it'll be in. I mean, I haven't heard anything if Orlando's willing to.
At this point, it's not happening, but it could happen if during the summer transfer window.
Yeah, because he only did just get there in July, so it's not like he's been there.
But this is his second stint. Months. This is his second stint or third stint or fourth stint, because he came up. Right. He came up with their academy back in the U19s. Then he went to Man United. Right. Man United loaned him to Sporting. Then he came back, went to Turkey, went to Valencia in Spain, went to Italy. Then he was loaned to Italy. Then came back to Valencia. Valencia then transferred him, or he went on a free to Sporting. For his essentially third stint.
You've been quite a journeyman.
Right. So this isn't his first rodeo with Sporting, and could be the end of his third. We'll see.
I mean, like, I would say if transfer fees weren't involved, I'd put the percentage of it happening at a lot higher. But if there's anything near a $5 million valuation on him, I don't see Orlando City paying that.
I mean, if it's a DP.
I think it's also worth paying attention to whether if he's actually interested in coming to play to the United States.
Right.
Yeah.
But you think about it, if you look more into it, and this is something I've thought about. This is something that I've gained a lot of perspective from talking to a lot of soccer pundits, soccer experts, executives. I mean, you look at MLS and how much progress they've made. There's a lot of MLS clubs that have invested money in their training facilities, stadiums. I mean, and then you just look at the way of life here in the United States. That's very appealing to those players that are in Europe and want to make the jump to America, not necessarily to retire, but to live a better, more calmer life. Because if you think about it, most of these European players are superstars back in Europe. There isn't really no privacy. Now you come to the United States where soccer obviously is getting big, but it's not to the point where if you're walking down the street, you're going to get chased down by fans wanting autographs. That's appealing to players that are coming from Europe.
And especially if they have a family. For Orlando, you've got Disney, you've got Universal, you've got SeaWorld, you've got all the parks right over there.
The turnoff for me would be I4 Ultimate, but
just don't mention it when you're making the pitch to the players. You don't mention I4 Ultimate.
You gotta sugarcoat that pitch, man. But eventually these players will know how traffic is going into the state.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you got to remember Luis Muzy also said he doesn't want players coming here if they just want to go see Mickey Mouse. So I don't think that's going to be part of the pitch to Nani.
If they only want to go
come over here and you can hang out at Disney.
Yeah, that's part of the pitch. It's not the pitch.
No, I think they pitch obviously the stadium, the fan base, the culture here.
Yeah, it's mainly for people with families that you'll pitch the Mickey Mouse. But outside of that, you pitch everything else that Orlando City has.
We're talking about Florida here, where it's warm most of the year, so I'm pretty sure that's another thing they pitch. Hey, this is Florida; it's pretty warm here.
Yeah,
summer gets blazing hot. So,
they talk about it a lot in like basketball free agency, but the no state tax too. More of your money goes into your pockets as opposed to, playing in Spain or whatever.
There are weird news here happening all the time. Florida man.
Yeah.
Why do you think we have a weird news segment on this show? As the Orlando Soccer Show, we need to bring attention to all the weird news that happened, not just in Florida, but outside as well.
It's our way of serving Floridians.
Something like that. All right, let's move on because we've already spent 40 minutes on Orlando City and we've still got a whole other part of the show to get to. So I want to go through some stuff. And by stuff, I mean Orlando City stuff. The jersey coming out this Friday. It's going to be unveiled at Lions Pride Friday afternoon. For those wondering, and I know they haven't announced this yet, but there will be a stream, a live stream of the event, so you can actually get to see how it's unveiled and everything. So you don't have to drive all the way downtown. You don't have to pay for parking if you don't want to. It should still be a fun event, and go if you can, but you know, you won't be missing out by not being there, if that makes any sense. Well, you guys have seen the jersey. I've seen the jersey now. It was leaked on Reddit. It's a replica.
It's
not the authentic. It's kind of an idea of what it'll look like. It's not officially what it'll look like, but I mean, that's basically what it is. Thoughts? Well,
it's about time they have a new jersey.
What's the difference between that and what leaked on Footy Headlines? Is it that there was white instead of the black?
Basically, but the pattern is a little different on the front, and from what I've seen, it's a little like the black is a little bit darker when you see it in person. Like the leak doesn't do it as much of a justice as it is.
Yeah,
because I mean, from what I've seen, it looks a little better than that. I mean, it's different. All the jerseys for Adidas this year are different in one way or another. But we can take solace in the fact that at least we don't have RSL's home or away jersey.
I much prefer their away jersey over almost every other away jersey, though. So the freaking printer broke of the away jerseys.
Yeah, I mean, if you put it in context like that, sure.
I mean, at least it's just not plain white. That's that's all it takes now to get to be considered a good away kit is to not just be plain ass white.
Yeah. Now, if they ran with this is the
mayonnaise of jerseys.
Yeah. If they ran with the official like the printer broke jerseys, if they like run with that, I'd be thrilled with that, and I'd mm-hmm. love the jersey more. But right now, it's just kind of.
I'm curious to know if they're gonna have a new away jersey, or they're gonna stay with the Origins white jersey from last season
for Orlando.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's staying. They alternate next new jerseys year. Every year. So this year you're getting the home, next year you're getting the away.
Oh,
next year they'll get the new basic template that Adidas hands out.
Yeah, well they're not doing too much of a basic template anymore, it seems. They're trying to broaden their horizons a little bit.
It'll still be all white with some purple trim.
Basically. All right. Let's go talk about some TV deals. Orlando City announced officially that they will be moving from TV 27 to Fox 35/My 65, back where they were originally for their MLS origins. We kind of talked about it on the show last week. We kind of knew they weren't going to be on TV 27. We just weren't sure where they were going to be next year. But Fox 35 and My 65 back like it was in 2015. That will be their home. Orlando City is going to be doing most of the production themselves, so it'll be like all in-house, all all related to them. All their content team will be working with Fox to be able to produce their own content and such. They're going to, I believe, try and do their own TV show like Channel 9 tried to do with their anchors, but basically Orlando will try and produce it themselves with their own people involved.
Well, they had Orlando City Insider with My 27.
Right, but that was with the 27 anchors. This would be with Orlando City's folks, so like Jenny Chu, Miguel Gallardo, and whoever else they decide to bring along. It would be with them.
Mm.
But that's still a little ways away. They're still trying to figure things out over there, and so that's something you could watch out for, possibly on My 65, to be able to premiere maybe a little bit later in the season. I know that's something they're definitely looking into and they want to try and do. Now, speaking of content just in general, right? They had the Bleed Purple documentary. I don't know if you guys saw that at all.
Yeah, I saw it. It was pretty cool. It was pretty dope, but dope stuff from the content team.
Yeah, so I know a lot of people were like, oh, why haven't they done this? And you know, why are they just starting to do this now? You know, because it's been kind of vanilla when it comes to some content sometimes with Orlando City. And there's reasons for that, but I'm not going to get into too much of that now. Basically, Orlando City's communications and content team have now merged together, which allows Orlando City's content team to produce more content because they have access to more, right? They've talked to James O'Connor. James is cool with all they're doing right now. Jason Christ was not, which is why nothing was ever produced like this. You know, new season allows the content team to be able to start off on a good foot with a coach that is allowing them a lot of access. And so Orlando wants to be able to produce their own content like this more often. And I mean, you saw a little bit of what they're capable of with the Bleed Purple. And we all kind of knew this was, well, I knew this was possible for the content team, but they were just kind of handcuffed in years past because of the coaching staff in charge. But now that they have a bit of more free rein, you'll be seeing a lot more like high quality content compared to other teams. They're gonna start blowing teams out of the water.
Interesting.
Yeah. So a little background behind that, because you know people were like, "Oh, well, when did we get a new content?" It's literally the exact same team that's been there the last 2 years.
As well, that
like the,
yeah,
the exact same team, but they're just their chains have been broken basically.
Well, that's good. I mean, they put dope content up with the Bleed Purple doc. It'll be interesting to see what other dope stuff they come out with, because
there's a lot of good stuff that's in the chamber right now.
Yeah, because I know usually Ryan's very creative, and obviously when he gets creative, some nice stuff usually comes out.
The Bleed Purple documentary was basically all Joe Madden. Joe's been with the team for forever, and he just quietly does his work. Right, he's friendly kind of guy, but he's very quiet when it comes to getting his work done. But he's really good at what he does, like really good. And that entire documentary was all him. He edited it together. He filmed most of it. And yeah. So you get an idea just of what the content team is capable of. I think that's all the Orlando City stuff that I have to talk about. Let's move on to the league, MLS in general. And let's talk a little bit about all the other jerseys. We kind of hinted about the RSL jersey. FC Cincinnati just released theirs earlier.
Fire.
It's actually good. I'm surprised.
Actually, very good.
FC, we're talking about FC Cincinnati?
Yeah. I like the jersey.
It's all right.
I think best
which one are you looking for? Because they released two. They released the home and away. Which one are you looking at?
Look, I don't get what's up with Twitter being upset with white jerseys. I like white jerseys. I mean, maybe because I'm a Real Madrid fan, but I honestly...
Yeah, that's what it is.
Let's not talk about white jerseys because it's probably going to trigger some people.
Wow.
I guess it's all right. I think MC Cincinnati had the hoops last year during USL. Now they have the stripes. I wish they would have kept the hoops, but I don't know. Maybe Adidas kind of dictated on how the template's going to be. But it's an all right jersey. Real Salt Lake's jersey, I'm a big fan of. The New York Red Bulls glitch jersey is pretty dope as well. It's their away jersey, right? The glitch one, gray one.
Yeah. I do appreciate the gray jersey. I'm not a huge fan of the RSL jersey, to be honest.
Sporting Kansas City always has the best jersey in the league, in my opinion.
They have a pretty good one this year.
And I mean, yeah, they I don't even know how to describe it. I'm opening up my Instagram account right now and see if I can get a look at it. But I like it.
Atlanta's going from being the 5 stripes to the 9 stripes, so that's fun.
Yeah, I feel like that's kind of going to trigger some fans.
Turning into a basic knockoff AC Milan jersey.
Yeah. I don't know. So there's only, what, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 jerseys officially released so far.
Who else? Did New York City FC drop a new home jersey this year?
Not yet officially, I don't think.
I think I saw it and it looks good.
Yeah, there was a leak of it, but it's not official yet.
Yeah.
DC United, Montreal Impact.
Montreal was really nice. I like that one. They usually do a pretty good job with their home kits.
LA Galaxy is not dropping a new home kit, I think. They're sticking with the...
No, they're dropping a new away kit, I believe. Because they just dropped a new home kit last year.
New England Revolution.
Yeah. Yeah, they've dropped their official jersey. It's...
I don't know, man. I love the Sporting Kansas City home jersey, man.
Yeah, the SKC jersey is great.
Yeah, I might buy it. I mean, not MLS related. The Chattanooga Red Wolves. I like their jersey.
Mm.
I don't know if you saw it already.
Yeah, no, it was just like a few hours ago. Being
yeah, they dropped it not too long ago. It was. Now I'm pulling it up. Now it's
good.
I like it.
No, they did a good job with that.
It's obviously League One team, so
yeah. All right. Well, enough about jerseys. Let's kind of continue on because we're treading water here a little bit. Quincy Ameriquois, Quincy time heading to DC United to be a depth striker for them. Kind of an interesting move. You know, he's had his ups and downs in his career, but DC kind of adding a little bit of depth behind Rooney, Acosta, you know, Patrick Mullins even. Couldn't hurt. You know, he's a veteran guy.
That's, I think, Tenorio dropped that. Stephen Goff dropped that news of Quincy Ameriquois going to DC. And in I think it was during lunchtime Monday. Obviously, we're recording Monday, so it was lunchtime today.
Mm-hmm.
And I started thinking about, wow, Quincy Ameriquois has become somewhat of a journeyman in Major League Soccer. I mean, Sporting Kansas City, Chicago Fire.
Wait, was he Sporting Kansas City?
No, I'm sorry, San Jose Earthquakes. San Jose. Yeah. I'm so in love with that jersey that I had to say Sporting Kansas City. but so San Jose Earthquakes, Chicago Fire, Montreal Impact. So he's been.
He's been around. Yeah, he's 31 at this point. So he's been with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 now. 7 teams will be officially when he signed with DC.
Hmm.
So he usually spends about 2 years in a place, right? Yeah. He went back to San Jose after starting his career there from 2015 to 2018, and then he's most recently been with Montreal. So, yeah, good for him. Other MLS news that's going on, Amobi Okugo, former Orlando City player back in 2015, he is signing with Austin Bold, the USL Championship side. After taking a year sabbatical from soccer, he wasn't sure if he was going to be playing again, and well, now he is. So, congrats to Moby, and best of luck to him. Back to the Philly situation, Philadelphia Union, right? Orlando City's playing them in a preseason scrimmage tomorrow, being today, being Tuesday.
Marcos Fabian debut for Philly?
That's what I was about to say, yeah. Could be if Marcos Fabian debut for the Union in a preseason game. Fabian just signed the other day with the Union as a DP. For those who recognize the name, he's a Mexican national team player. He's been around for many years. He's an incredibly successful player, and it was kind of a big coup for them to sign him because he's not 30 years old yet, basically. You know, and for some reason, the Mexican teams and, you know, Mexican national team people, they always look down on Mexican national team players going to MLS. Before their time is up with the Mexican national team,
man, the Mexican people get on their players when they come back to Mexico. They're like, why are you coming?
Why are you coming back here? It's just like they can't do anything right, basically.
I don't know, but
unless you go to Real Madrid or Barcelona, you're not doing it right.
I did see something too. I think it was either like his father or his agent mentioned that this might just be like a short term thing. Try to get back to Europe eventually. So I mean, who knows how long this will even last, but it'll be, you know, fun to watch because he's certainly a really talented player.
Yeah,
and Philly could definitely use a guy like him.
Yeah, considering that whole David Akam thing didn't work out.
Yeah, a lot of things don't work out for them. They do have a this new American midfielder. I don't remember what his name is, but he sounds like a promising up and comer.
Wait, well, they had the goalkeeper situation not too long ago, too, and they signed, like, 4 starting goalkeepers.
Yeah. When they had that DP goalkeeper who was a train wreck.
Oh, man, I started thinking about the other day about the New York Red Bulls a couple years back when Hans Backe was the head coach, and it was when they had Buna Kondul as their starting goalkeeper, and then Greg Sutton took that spot. Because Buna just lost his form, then Greg Sutton was not that great. Then they ended up signing the Red Bulls ended up signing a goalkeeper, a DP, and Frank Rost, and he was already like 40 years old. Yeah, that was before Red Bulls tasted anything. They tasted any silverware. And then obviously Bakke left and Mike Pecky came and supporter shields came more often for the Red Bulls. Those were the days.
Yeah. I can't. Who was that guy for Philly that they signed? Was it the Algerian goalkeeper?
Yeah.
I don't remember what his name is, but.
Rais Mboli.
Yep.
Yeah. There you go. Yeah. Rais Mboli. He lasted all of 9 games.
There's always that, like.
Where the hell? Well, where is he now? He's playing at El Etifak.
What?
El Etifak.
What the F?
It's a Saudi Arabian team.
Okay, so he's going to play against Sebastian Giovinco now.
Yeah.
Nice.
Who would have thought that Rais Mboli and Sebastian Giovinco would play against each other?
Where's Xavi? United Arab Emirates, the UAE? Xavi Hernandez.
Yeah, Xavi's playing in Qatar.
Qatar, there you go.
Yeah. All right, so outside of Fabian, let's talk about some other teams and other leagues. Well, MLS still, but Darlington Nagbe might be on his way out of Atlanta.
That's interesting.
So before you get into that, the situation is that apparently he's not been playing in any preseason games for Atlanta. He hasn't been like showing up to things, and he's basically trying to force a transfer.
Well, he was late to, according to can't believe I forgot his name. Doug Robertson
for the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. So what's his deal? He's trained with the team since it arrived in LA on February 1st, but the club declined to say what Nagbe won't train. Or made the decision why he won't train, and Nagbe has declined several interview requests to this point.
I was reading that evidently he's from Ohio. He's in that region, family close to there. Obviously played with Caleb Porter in Portland, probably wants to go back there. So it's going to be an interesting situation because if he wants out, he wants to go to Portland. If you're Portland, or not Portland, he wants to go to Columbus. If you're Columbus, you're not going to pay a lot of money for a guy who's basically, you know, you're not necessarily trying to get. But if he wants to go there, if you're Atlanta, you're going to have to settle for, you know, a pretty small deal, all things considered. So who knows if Atlanta budges and they're willing to settle and let him out. But it doesn't look like he's going to be coming back. And if he does, it's not going to be it's going to be a little awkward, I would say.
Yeah. I mean, he's 28 years old at this point now. Yeah. He's starting to get up there in age. He's still a very effective midfielder. And if he wants to go join Caleb Porter in Columbus, that's a game changer for them, potentially.
Yeah, that's for sure.
But he's kind of had a struggle in his time in Atlanta. Right. Last year, he was injured for a lot of it. So should be very interesting. And speaking of former Columbus Crew players, this just came up in my Twitter feed a few minutes ago, and I was kind of just pissed because if you remember, this was not during the show, but this was before the show a few weeks ago. I think it was you and me, Gavin. We were talking about Kakuta Mane, right? He used to be a Vancouver Whitecaps and Columbus Crew player, most notably for his time in Vancouver. He was incredibly quick. He was, you know, one of the quickest players in MLS at one point. I think FIFA had him at like a 96 overall speed, which is very fast. He left Columbus in 2017 to go to Pachuca in Mexico. It really did not work out for him there. Then he went to St. Gallen in Switzerland, and he's been there for the past season, been there since 2018. He's only played 7 games, and now, apparently, according to Paul Tenorio, he's heading to Cincinnati.
I saw this, and I'm interested by it, and I don't know. Like, this team might just be terrible this year if the defense doesn't hold up, which is basically what they're building their entire team around. But this is certainly a good addition to make sure that they can at least score a couple goals if the defense doesn't kind of let them down.
Mane is only 24 years old. Right, he's still super young. You wouldn't you wouldn't think that because he's been in the league since 2013.
Mm-hmm.
All right, that was what, 5 years ago?
Yeah.
6 years ago now.
I mean, he signed with Columbus in 2017. He came into the league
2013. That's 6 years ago, right?
Yeah. I mean, he's joining a front line that's got Fernando Audi, Darren Maddox. I mean, there's a lot of MLS talent that Cincinnati is certainly coming with. They're not going to join the league like an Atlanta or an LAFC, but certainly probably a lot better than Minnesota came in a couple of years ago. So
yeah, I really like Akutamane's game.
Yeah, I like it. I like it as a signing. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, and for those curious, he does actually have a little bit of a connection to Texas. He played for the Austin Aztecs back in 2012. He was born in Gambia, but he is now a U.S. international. Because back in 2017, he was playing so well for Vancouver and then Columbus, he was thought to be a big thing for the U.S. men's national team. So if he can get back to that point, if he still has the speed that he had even just like 2 years ago, God, he'll be very effective in MLS, and he could be a big game changer for Cincinnati. And we were just talking the other day, like, oh, you know, he's kind of wasting away out in Switzerland. He should probably make his way back to MLS. Orlando City could use a guy like him, but, well, Cincinnati's got him instead.
Yeah, I mean, was in March camp last year. He's also a U.S. citizen, so, I mean, it's works out on the international page, works out. It could be a good signing, so we'll see what happens with that.
And again, he's only 24, right? He's got a proven track record in MLS. That's the latest thing. Let's talk about some other world news, and by world I mean just north of the border here in the U.S. The Canadian Premier League is making its strides to begin their first ever season. Signed a lot of players, not many Americans, because you would think like that kind of fringe American players might go up to Canada to go play in the Canadian Premier League. But no, it's mainly been a lot of Canadians and then foreign players up there so far. But you've got a healthy kind of mix of a lot of those guys. I don't know if you guys have looked at any of the rosters lately.
Not yet. I haven't really dug too much into the Premier League. Kind of going to what you're saying, though. I mean, like, if you're a fringe U.S. player, there's so many opportunities here in the States now with not just USL, but, you know, League One, League Two.
Right.
I think isn't the whole point of the Canadian Premier League to further the development of Canadian soccer?
Basically, yeah, I mean, yeah. It's their only professional league now that I know of, right?
So, I mean, I think it doesn't have to, I mean, I would imagine it gives, it opens up more opportunities for Canadian born players. And I mean, it's Canada's league, you know. It'll be interesting to see how it grows.
You've got a lot of guys that have former USL guys, career USL guys that are Canadians that have moved back up. You know, yeah. you got a guy like Kyle Becker, right? He started his career with Toronto. He's been around the league over a few years, made his way out to USL and NASL with San Francisco and North Carolina. Right, he's like the premier signing for Forge FC, which is going to be playing out in, where are they playing? Hamilton in Ontario at Tim Hortons Field. Tim Hortons is a very big thing up in Canada, if you've ever had it.
Yeah. Why can't I think of his name? Who is the other Orlando City player that was a Canadian, not Kyle Aaron.
Richie Larea,
yeah. Where's he at nowadays?
Last I heard, he was training with Toronto, but I don't think he's anywhere. He could be a prime candidate for this league, potentially.
Yeah, I mean, you think of not necessarily like a star, but one of the better players. That's, I mean, somebody that can really go up there and try to not only help his homeland, but build a reputation for himself to kind of get back into the Major League Soccer per field.
Yeah. And speaking of former Orlando players, there's actually been one that signed for a club. Don't know if you guys caught this at all. It's an Orlando City B player. And no. any guesses?
I don't remember.
There's not too many Canadians that have been players. For OCB. It's Michael Cox. He's signed for York.
He's Canadian?
Yes, he is Canadian. Did you not know that?
He played for Ottawa, right?
Shit, I mean, I know he scored a ton of goals for OCB at one point.
No, he did. He did not. He did not. He joined OCB.
Well, I don't want to say a ton, but he had a little bit of a goal.
Yeah, he had a good spurt of goals. He scored 13 in 45 games. He signed with Nashville in 2018, then transferred to St. Louis and played with Anthony Pulis again last year. And then this year he's gone up to Canada to go back home.
York Nine Cox. No, he did play for FC Edmonton though. But
that was earlier though.
Maybe I'm thinking from some. It's like came from Ottawa.
Yeah, maybe. Anyways, York is going to be in Toronto, in a suburb of Toronto. They're actually playing. The reason they're called York Nine is because they're playing at York University.
I wonder if they'll have a Degrassi United popping up pretty soon.
That'd be funny.
Drake is the owner.
Yeah, right.
If you get Drake to buy into this league, there's no telling where it could go.
I mean, he's always throwing some soccer stuff in his lyrics.
Does he?
Yeah, he's his old tracks. I mean, I'm not gonna say it on radio, but he's like, you can't miss the boy, me and my boy united like Van Nistelrooy.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I remember that.
And then in his latest album in Scorpion, or was it More Life, this past summer, he said something, the way I'm living life, you think I'm like Ronaldo in Madrid.
He'll throw little bits of like sports lyrics into his tracks. It's always interesting to see.
I just butchered Drake up. My bad, bro. Oh, my bad, dude. I don't know if he listens to our podcast, but
that's good. It's good. Moving on. All right. Man City and Chelsea. It hurts to talk about because I'm a Chelsea fan. They got dunked on.
They got mauled.
It was bad. It was really bad. They were down 3-0 before the 25th minute.
Damn.
And I'm so glad I didn't watch that game. I had a feeling in the back of my head. I'm like, this is going to be a really, really bad game. And sure enough, it was. 6-0 at the end of it. They almost lost 7. They came pretty close to continuing to let up goals, but thankfully they didn't. And now, of course, there's the big question, what's happening with Chelsea? Because they're now sitting 6th in the standings. Arsenal's ahead in 5th. They were having such a great season to start, and now it's kind of tailed off. They've been losing games that they probably shouldn't have, and then winning games that they probably should. So they're kind of just struggling at this point. And the way that Chelsea kind of runs with their managers, I don't know how much patience they'll have. You know, Maurizio Sarri was a great hire. I love his tactics. I love his mentality, but just like, it's just not working right now.
Maybe the players are not working.
He did call out his players. Like, I can't work with these guys.
I mean, obviously you're a Chelsea fan, but sometimes it goes in soccer. It goes both ways. Obviously the players are not working, then obviously the coach has the ability to get rid of them and then bring his own players. But obviously, knowing how Chelsea's run with Roman Abramovich, there's a lot of pressure, right? I mean, you have to, you're held to a certain standard, and if you don't meet that standard, you get the axe.
Pretty much.
Just ask Jose Mourinho.
Yeah.
Antonio Conte.
Yeah.
Carlo Ancelotti. Rafa Benitez. I mean, Chelsea's gone through a lot of managers.
They have.
Di Matteo.
Too many. Too many. All right. Anyways, the last thing that we'll talk about with the world news, we got Champions League coming up this coming week. All right. PSG's playing Man United, which should be an interesting one. Some of the Seawolves guys are actually going to be out at that game. Yeah, they've flown all the way out there for that because they have this week off, so why not? In other kind of more depressing, sad news, Emiliano Sala, who was supposed to be transferring to Crystal Palace. His plane crashed and they found his body the other day. So there was a lot of outpouring of emotions over the last like week and a bit from Nantes in France and then Crystal Palace as well. It's just a tragic scene, and you know, for a player that actually has some MLS connections, he was teammates with Ale Bedoya in France when Bedoya was out there, and then I believe he was with teammates with Lamine Sané for a time as well. So yeah, a few connections there, and you saw like Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, you know, outpouring of support for him and his family, and you know, tough to see. But it's nice to see. What is nice to see is the outpouring of support from the entire football community, and how they kind of rallied around that.
No, it was really sad news. It was Cardiff City he was transferring to.
Cardiff, yes. What did I say?
Crystal Palace.
No, yeah. Cardiff.
But I pulled up his stats here. This is a player who was still young. Mm-hmm. Obviously reaching his peak of his career, 48 goals in 133 games with Nantes of the French league. So obviously that led to him getting transferred to Cardiff City, and obviously fate had other plans and resulted into this accident, and a young player gone too soon from this world, from the game. So definitely another tragic loss for the sport.
I mean, like when you think about what's happened in the Premier League this year, you know, with Leicester's owner passing too, it's just, you know, makes you kind of fortunate that these things don't happen here as often.
Let's move on and let's end the bulk of this show. Let's move on to our weird news, red cards, and predictions. So we'll start with the weird news. Who's got some good weird news?
I have a good one.
All right, go for it.
So headline, and this is coming from Texas City, Texas. Grandma fights off attackers in clown masks with child scooter. The headline says it there. Aretha Cardinal used the scooter to strike one attacker and break the window of the escape vehicle. So, and that's the subheadline. And then I'll just read the lead off this story. Police say a Texas woman used her granddaughter's scooter to defend herself against a pair of machete-wielding men wearing clown masks who attempted to rob the woman and her husband. So, grandma took... Don't mess with grandma, man.
I mean, they learned the lesson. Gavin, you got a good one?
I do. It comes from Minnesota. Kind of goes into the category if you only had one job. It's a security guard at sex offender treatment center accused of having sex with a patient. So let's see. Claudia Kogo was charged with felony counts of criminal sexual conduct. According to court documents, a patient who was committed there as a sexually dangerous person. He had sex with this person over 24 times. So they apparently had a relationship. And so kind of the one thing, you're guarding these people, shouldn't be fooling around with them.
Yeah. No, don't do that. That's bad. I've got one in kind of sports related. So I don't know if you guys heard about the Alliance of American Football, the AAF. Yep. All right, just started out. Orlando's got a team, the Orlando Apollos. They beat they won their first game against Atlanta by a big margin as well. But there was another team that, you know, there's other teams that play. One team was without one of their players because he was arrested before the game.
Mm-hmm. What?
Yeah. So
I did see this one.
You did?
Yeah, for Alabama or Montgomery, whatever it is.
Yeah, the Birmingham Iron player. This was Lawrence Okoye. He was arrested in a prostitution sting. There were 13 others arrested, but it was part of Operation Closeout Round 3. And, he's apparently on the injured list for he was on their injured list for their game on Sunday due to a groin injury. So, groin injury, prostitution sting,
whatever you want to call it.
Totally, you know, doesn't.
Potato, potato.
Yeah, you know. I mean, it kind of all goes together, I guess. Yeah. Maybe he has a groin injury from the prostitution sting. I don't know. you can totally read into that as much as you can, as much as you want.
Yeah, just go ahead and fill in the blanks. It's up to you.
Or don't. That's probably a better idea. Don't fill in the blanks.
That too.
Yeah. All right, red cards. Guys, who are or what are you pissed off at this week?
I'm pissed off at my professor.
who isn't at one point or another, right?
I will not disclose the name. However,
that's a safe thing to do.
It's a little frustrating as a student. If we have any other listeners that are students, when you have a professor that is very unorganized, says certain things are uploaded to the web courses, which is with usually a hybrid classes, and they're not uploaded and you can't access it. And he responds every 2 days, doesn't respond back immediately. It's just a long list, but I wish the class would be organized because this is my last semester at UCF and I don't want to deal with any BS, but obviously I'm dealing with it. So red card to el profesor.
Fair enough. Gavin.
I would give a red card to the lady at the drive-thru in Pooler, Georgia. Just a complete train wreck. So we get there, and this girl she keeps talking over me. She's not understanding any of the things that I'm saying to her. And eventually she got mad and, like, started sassing me, and it was a whole big thing. So I'm going to give her a red card. She is clearly not into it.
Hmm. Okay. Damn. Well, I mean, you were in Georgia, so.
Yeah, I mean, it was just over the Georgia border. It was our welcome into the state, and not a good one.
Yeah, Georgia hospitality, isn't that a thing?
Yeah, exactly. Pretty much southern hospitality there in Georgia.
All right, I'll give somewhat of a red card to Fox 35's production team.
Nope.
Yeah, so they released a video a few days ago, showing off things to do in Orlando, right? And one of them was an Orlando City Stadium tour. You know, they were talking about, like, oh, yeah, you can go see the locker rooms, you can go see the press box and everything, and tickets are only $20, and that's great. Yeah, good information. Yeah, they showed the Citrus Bowl.
Camping World Stadium.
It's the Citrus Bowl to me. I will never call it the Camping World Stadium.
It costs $20 to get a tour of the stadium?
Yeah, that's like any other stadium tour around, basically. Like you go to Chelsea Stadium in England, they'll charge you $35. No, they'll charge about $25.
I think Yankee Stadium was like $25.
See,
is food included?
Food included? I would doubt it. I think they just show you around and then send you on your merry way. Go have then you can go out and get some food on Paramore.
They have some good ribs, I heard.
Yeah.
Ooh, that North Carolina barbecue was very good. If you guys go there.
Yeah.
Authentic.
One of these days, we'll have to have a debate about which barbecue is best. There's some good barbecue.
There's going to be some hot takes on that.
There will be some hot takes. Mike's already starting off by saying it's Four Rivers.
Mm. That's.
You need to get out more.
I'm good at Four Rivers.
I mean, don't get me wrong. Four Rivers is as good as it gets in like this area.
Here's another red card to Four Rivers. Their quality has declined over the last 2 years.
Oh,
because they have expanded more. Their quality has gone down.
They diluted.
Yeah, unfortunately, it doesn't happen.
They've diluted the quality of the product.
Exactly, which is why they're not as good as they used to be.
Ah, man, I haven't ate Four Rivers in probably 3 months. Now I don't feel like going to Four Rivers this weekend.
You should, just so you can see how it's turned out. Scared. You're scared. You don't want the good times to be ruined.
No, man. Not at all.
I mean, that's fair enough.
The one I went to in Jacksonville wasn't bad. It was, as good as I remember it being.
Yeah. Wait, Gavin, since you're in Jacksonville, have you been to Whataburger yet?
I went to a Whataburger, not since I've lived here, but I have been to a Whataburger, and I didn't really think it was all that great.
See, that's another hot take, because most people that I talk to say Whataburger is the best fast food.
I mean, it's possible that it was because I was getting it at like 10:30 at night after the
yeah,
US
that's not
game
the that's
that
not the right
years ago.
Yeah, it's not the right time to get it.
I wasn't all that impressed. I would probably have to go back again to get a better read on it.
Right. We could do an entire show on just hot takes on food.
Yeah, I'm sure one day when we run out of things to talk about.
Yeah, well, we'll have to get Kyle in here because he has some really hot takes on food.
Kyle has some out there food takes.
Yeah. So next time we do a show like that, we'll get Kyle on.
Yeah.
Let's finish this show out with predictions. We actually have an Orlando City game to predict. This not like a closed door friendly. Orlando City is playing NYCFC in the first game of the Orlando City Invitational. Guys, who wins?
I'm going to go draw.
All right. Their first ever preseason match was a 1-1 draw.
I actually have a question. What's the rules? Is there draws? Do there has to be a winner? Who wins the Orlando City Invitational?
I'm pretty sure there's draws. There is no winner. I think they're just games.
Yeah, I don't think plays everyone, right?
It's not I don't think it's a tournament. I think it's just games that they're playing.
Yeah.
Oh, damn. I was hoping for some sort of...
You were hoping for some sort of competition? No. That's too much for them.
I'm going to say Orlando City, just for the fact that they're at home. Obviously, fans are going to be able to be at the game. And I'm not really sure how New York City FC has been doing since in the post-David Villa era.
I mean, they've signed a few players, but yeah, they're definitely kind of looking more youthful than years past.
Yeah, and if Dwyer it does not play, they have Tesho playing, and Tesho has MLS experience, and it'll be interesting to see how that partnership. Because something I've noticed during training is Sasha Kljestan walking out with Tesho, and they're always usually conversing, and it seems like they're talking, they're building a good chemistry off the pitch. And I'm curious to know how their chemistry is going to be on the pitch, and if we're going to see a lot of connections between Kljestan and Tesho, and if that is the case, I'd like to see how it comes to fruition against NYCFC this Saturday.
Yeah, I'll go draw. I do just hard to judge on preseason games.
Well, win or lose or draw, it's preseason.
Yeah, preseason. We should have repeated this in the beginning, but preseason results don't matter. Nothing matters in the preseason. Everyone who reads into the preseason results just should go away for a bit. Come back when there's the actual games that are played.
I want to know who's going to be the rookie of the best player of preseason. Not honestly rookie, but
you like the Chris Mueller was last year.
Well, then Pedro Ribeiro was their best player during preseason a couple years back as well.
Yeah.
So I want to know who is the
They haven't really had too many, like... There really hasn't been, like, a breakout goal scorer or anything, you know?
No, not yet, so...
We'll see. Anyway, moving on to the next game. Ajax playing Real Madrid. We're getting into Champions League stuff now.
Madrid's probably the safe bet here.
Yeah, I'd say so. And we all know where Mike is going because he's a Los Blancos fan.
Yep.
There we go. So everyone going with Real Madrid, which is, again, a safe bet. Tottenham playing Borussia Dortmund.
League leaders Borussia Dortmund, that is. So I'm going to go Dortmund.
Harry Kane's out, so I'm going Dortmund as well.
They do have Song back, though, who is still playing pretty well.
But Harry Kane is out.
Yeah, no, that pretty much disqualifies them.
It doesn't disqualify them. I think it just it's not as helpful.
Yeah.
It's going to be the Jadon Sancho show. With a little bit of Pulisic, Marco Royce. So, yeah, I'm going for Borussia Dortmund.
All right. The game we teased a little earlier that the Seawolves guys are going to be at, Man U PSG. In Manchester, by the way.
I feel like I have to go with Man U just because of the way they've been playing. I mean, this is really their first kind of big test. But I'm still confident that they'll get it.
No test whatsoever. It's Man United. No Neymar, no Cavani, no Verratti, no. Man, PSG's just banged up.
Yeah. If those guys were there, it would have been closer, but it's hard to go against Man U because they are healthy and PSG's not.
Yeah. Man, Pogba's on fire all of a sudden, too.
Yeah. The entire team's been just killing it right now.
Man, the Red Devils are on fire.
Ha ha. Ha.
Insert drum kick.
Last game is going to be Roma versus Porto.
Draw in this leg.
Mike?
I want to say draw as well.
Well, the last time these two teams faced each other, I think Roma won, right?
Yeah, yeah. But
I'm going to go Roma. And I guess that is that. The end.
Oh. Thanks for tuning in this week, everyone. Follow us on Twitter. Download, like, subscribe, share.
All the things that everybody else says. Yeah. You've heard them from every... Like, if you watch a YouTube video or listen to anything else on the radio or the internet, you've heard the pitch. You've heard the shtick. You know what we're going to say, so there's no point in saying it, right?
Yeah, by the way, follow our YouTube page. Josh. We haven't done anything on it yet.
We don't need to say anything, but by the way, follow our YouTube page.
Yeah, we don't do anything with it, just follow it.
It literally just auto posts the shows.
Yeah. If I get back into the mood to do more video content, there may be video content.
Well, we also have the Orlando Soccer Journal, where we'll hopefully be having some more written content coming out next week or the week week or two. Next, when there's going to be some games going on, we'll have some recaps, we'll have some breakdowns, we'll have some stuff going up and all that nonsense as well. Plus, we'll be bringing back the post-game shows, not on Saturday, because I will be in Lakeland for the Seawolves game, but on Wednesday when they play the New England Revolution, Mike and I should be in the press box for that post-game show, as well as the James O'Connor post-game press conference. So, you can look forward to all of that coming up in the next week. We'll be back with another episode. Probably next week or the week after. But as the season rolls closer and closer to coming along, we will be rolling out more and more content. So, for Mike Gramajo, for Gavin Ewbank, my name's Austin David. Thanks for listening to another episode of the Orlando Soccer Show. We'll see you next time.